In this video, I will tell you a few quick things about what you have to consider when we work with multiple files and imports. So far, we've only presented the two Python notebooks and expected you to work with normal files. And now I just want to say one or two things about what happens if you work with multiple files. So first of all, consider these two files. So we have this complexBehavior.py, and we have inside this the function do complicated stuff, which doesn't do sugarmaid stuff here, and then we run it inside this function. Okay, so now if we run this, where this prints view this out twice. Now imagine we wanted to import the behavior from this function here. They're in the same directory, so you can simply import complexBehavior. Now if something false, I don't want to print the global bus here, but I only want to import the complex behavior, and if this false condition is true, then I want it to run complicated stuff. Now if I run this file, I'm going to see this still wants it. And why does it want it? Because when I'm importing this complex behavior, I'm running this complex behavior file from top to bottom, and I'm also running this part here. And this is why you should always have a main function in Python, just like in Java, just a bit smaller. So there is this variable, and that's the underscore underscore name underscore underscore. And that name is the name of the of the thing that Python executes. And if you execute this very file, if you execute this very file, then this name variable is set to main, and otherwise it's set to other variables. Okay, so now this here is only true, this condition, if this is the script I'm running. So if I print this condition here, now if I'm running complexBehavior.py, it's going to print true, and if I'm running file 1, it's going to print false. Because, well, let's print underscore underscore name here. And this is then complex behavior, because I'm importing complex behavior. I'm importing it under the name complex behavior here. Okay, so this underscore underscore name, when imported by this, is something else. But we can use this condition to only execute stuff if I'm executing this as the main function. And that's this. Okay, so now if I'm running file1.py, I'm not running this here anymore, because I only want to run it when I want this very file. So for now, run Python complexBehavior.py, then it runs it, and otherwise it doesn't. Okay, and what you normally always do in Python is that you define also an actual main function. And what's just good style is that you define the main function at this very, that's to your main function to be the very first function to be actually in your code. And this, if name equals main, you have at the very, very end. Only those two lines at the very end. This makes your interpreter to run every single function in class there is. And then only after everything is run, it's going to go into the main function. But you still have whatever is in the main function at the top. If you don't do it like this, you run into problems where you may, for example, have undefined functions. So if I run it like this now, it doesn't work because it doesn't know main yet. Okay, so this is at the end. And this is what you do in every single program. So you shouldn't execute stuff in the non-indented areas, only under this. So setting up variables is fine, but in the non-indented areas, you shouldn't execute stuff. Okay, so we did this, and yeah. Okay, so so we see, so the main is the first global variables we defined before that, and even before that, so I would have to have the same thing here, main, def main, and then that in here, that would also be part of the main, and then again have the same thing as here, teeny tiny bit of code. Okay, and the imports are already before that. So we always have imports, then global variables, and then the functions, and then this part. Okay? And yes, pep8 tells you that if you import, you first import the standard lib packages, so the ones which are there without having to install them using pip or conda, so functools, for example. then the third library, third party libraries like NumPy or SciPy or whatever, and then your own code imports. So if I had other ports, I would import this here at the very last. Okay, and while you can import stuff inside functions or inside classes, this is not good style, because generally you want to be all your inputs at the top, such that if somebody looks at the code, they see what you imported. However, sometimes for example TensorFlow thing, you need to do it like this sometimes. Not good style, but yeah. Okay, then let's get to the concept of modules. Okay, Python code is split into packages which in turn contain modules. NumPy is a package. FuncTools is a package. So everything which you can import is a package, and what you're writing to will be a package if it's in a directory. Because generally you can say that packages are directories, and the files inside these packages are modules. So if you have a directory containing your code, and that's a package, and then the individual code files are modules. Generally, packages are either included with Python, then they are so-called standard lib packages, even though the standard lib doesn't really exist with that name for Python, or installed by a pip or conda, or made by you. Okay. Each module has its own private symbol table containing names, so variables basically, but with the thing as we saw 2 weeks ago, which is used as the global system table by all functions defined in the module. Thus, the author of a module can use global variables in the module without worrying about accidental clashes with a user's global namespace. What do I mean by this? Well, inside this complex behavior, I defined this global variable, right? And then inside this file, I defined the global variable as well. So what is now the value of global variable? Well, it will be this, it will be 2. Because if I'm importing complex behavior, this global variable is going to be under the namespace of complex behavior. So I have to complex behavior dot global var namespaces. So if I execute this, it's printing this is 2 and this is 5. So this is what I mean by this. Okay. So what kinds of imports are there? How can you import? So imagine this to be your packet structure for the beginning. So we have some directory that's called package, and inside that we have this dunder init.py. I'm going to explain that in a second, and a.py and b.py. So what we can do is we can import package.a, that's a so-called absolute import. We can import package.a as and then another name. So we can bind whatever we're importing from package.a to a different name, and we can use the alternate imported that, so from package import A. So if we now want to use this A, here we have to write package.a. So imagine A is some kind of function. So now we have to run package.a here. Here we have to run A mod, and here we can simply run A. Okay. So if you import something with syntax 3, you import names from a module into your importing module symbol table. So if I imported here, if I imported from complex behavior import global var, and I wouldn't override it here, then my global var would be 5, because I added this global var to my namespace here. All right. There's the syntax from package.a import star, which imports all names except those starting with an underscore. So this is the actual time stuff starting with an underscore has an actual kind of hiding use, but you shouldn't do this anyway, because importing everything from a pack from a module is bad style, because you import an unknown set of names, you don't know what is in there, and the end user may not know it, but importing with the star from multiple modules, you cannot tell where whatever you're using comes from. So if you're importing from package.a import star and from package.b import star, and then you're using somewhere in the function which wasn't defined in this module, but in either A or B, you have to look up in both because you don't know it, except you have a good IDE. And if I hide things already, you have already defined in your own package. When using s, you simply bind it to a name. So now this package.a has the name a mod. This is simply as if I would write package.a equals, or rather I mean a mod equals package.a. And you can combine the from syntax and the s syntax. So from package import a is a mod would work just as well. Okay. So let's get to a bit more complex package. So imagine we have this package structure. So we have some top level package called sound, and inside that, well, we have first of all this dunder init.py. I'm going to explain that now. And then inside that we have sub-packages, which in turn contain the dumb init and a few other files. So this is a realistically looking package. Okay. So what is now this dumb-init.py? Files named dumb-init.py are used to mark directories on the disk as Python package directories. So if there is a directory on your disk which contains this dumb-init.py, then it is a Python package. That's it. So when a regular package is imported, this dumb-init.py is implicitly executed and the objects are defined are bound to names in the package namespace. So if you write code inside this dumb-init.py, you can do that, and whenever you import that package, this is going to be executed. Normally these are empty, but you can define stuff inside that. Okay, so in this here, if we import sounds.formats, we're going to run this init.py and this init.py. So we have to have the inits in there, otherwise it's no package. And it's implicitly executed. Like I said, most of the time it's empty anyway. And then if we subsequently, for example, import sound.effects or sound.filters, then the respective dumb inits are going to be executed. Not this anymore, because this was already executed in Python Smart. Okay. So if we move this dumb-init.py file, Python will no longer look for submodules inside that directory, so attempts to import that module will fail. So it's only a module if they have the dumb-init. It's usually empty, but can be used to export selected portion of the package under more convenient names, some convenience functions, etc. So sometimes, for example, I write global variables. So if I have a file, if I have a module or some project containing multiple files and I want global variables to be in all files of this package, I write them in the dumb-init and I let every single file import the own project. So I would, for example, if I had a constant for which speaker I want to use, I would have it here. And then I would, in the waveread.py, I would simply import sound such that this here is surely executed. So yeah, the contents of the init module can thus be accessed once you import sound. So this is what I would do. So if I want to have global variables for everything, I would write them here and then simply import sound. Okay. And this adds for a further syntax, and that is when packages are structured into sub-packages, you can use relative imports. So imagine we are in this in the surround.py file here, and we could, for example, import from .import echo, so from the same module import another file, from the same package or sub-package import another module, from .dot import format, so from the parent package, from the top level package, import, and then I could import even the other sub-packages, and from .dot filters import equalize. So this works too, but only, so I can't make dot 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 if my dot 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 is not a package. Okay, so this works only in a top level with sub packages structure. As soon as there's one directory in between which doesn't have this dumb-init.py, it doesn't work anymore. Okay, so this adds to a list of how you can import. So I can also, from package, import A. I know I had that. So I can also import A, which is an implicit relative import, which worked in Python 2 and was shitty because this looks like we are importing something which is not, so now I'm again at this directory structure, right? So this looks as if we're, for example, importing NumPy, and this is shitty, and it only works in Python 2, and luckily they got rid of it. But I could also from dot import A, for example, which is the explicit relative import. Okay, what I can also do, which is kind of what I just told you, is I can put all imports into the study module, central module. So if I had this structure here again, I could, in my init.py, import from myself A and B, and then simply in A.py import the package. And this surely imports everything. Okay, and then I can simply call package.p.sum object. This works, but it's generally not the most elegant solution, as it always imports all submodules. Okay. If you want to know more about this importing, here's the documentation. And this, for example, also tells you what happens if you import from a package, star from a package. Okay, then real quick, circular imports. Consider this situation, which I actually had in a project of mine. So I have this bot server.py, which imports handle message. Handle message imports userdb, and userdb imports something from bot server. Now I want to run the handle message. And if I try to run it,
This is, oh, this is running. No, I don't want to one-handle message. I think I want to run userdb here. And this is what's happening. It cannot import db from bot server, even though it's there. Why is that? Because I'm having circular imports. UserDB relies on bot server, handle message relies on UserDB, and bot server relies on handle message. This is circular. Python is actually good at this, and Python can actually do this, but it can only do this for this, for the absolute import, and not for something like this here. So make sure that you don't do it like this. So this is just real quick. You can pause me if you want to know exactly how it works and look at it yourself. But if I do it like this, and I don't have the alternate import, now it runs. That's the caveat. Okay, so only method 1 and 4 work if you have circular dependencies here. So this and this. You never use SOAR, it's only Python 2, it's bad. Anyway, so yeah. So you're only able to import a module with a circular import dependency, even though it's bad style anyway. So I should have rewritten this such that I don't have the circular imports anyway, because it's a sign of bad style and I should somehow structure it differently. So you won't be able to import any objects defined in the module, you'll actually be able to reference that imported module anywhere in the top level of the module when I'm importing it. There's more information on this on this Stack Overflow post. And the last thing I want to show you concerning multiple files, or concerning working with files instead of notebooks, is the argparse module. So you've already seen probably that you can, to terminal commands, you can provide arguments. So for example, I can run ls, which lists me the contents of this directory. You can also ls minus a, which includes the hidden files, for example. So this here is an argument, and I can give these to my Python program just as well. So let's look at this argparse example here. Okay, so I recommend the argparse module, and that's really easy to use. So I import argparse, and then I can simply use this function, which I defined myself, command pass command line args. I'm creating an argument parser object, and I can simply add arguments. So for example, I have one necessary argument, which is called file name, and that's necessary. It doesn't have a default value. I have to give it to my program. So this is an example. I could not have it, and then I won't have to have this argument, right? I can also make arguments which are not necessary. So for example, this here is basically a named argument. So not a, this here is a position argument. And this here is if I run minus s or minus minus second argument, and then whatever the value is, then this here exists. And then I'm writing into my args.second underscore argument, that's the destination, I'm writing the value of whatever I had here. And then you always also provide a help, which is going to be shown if you use the argument minus minus help, and a default argument. So if you have a default value, so if you have a default value, then this here is not, you don't have to give this argument. Okay, and you can also make, for example, you can also make arguments where you can have a pass a list of arguments or something, or for example also booleans. So if I want, for example, the variable, so if I don't have the destination, then it's going to automatically know that it's going to be this, so the long version of the argument. So there's always a short, and not always, but you can define a short and a long version, and this here is going to be then args.verbose is going to be also a variable. Okay, and if I want this to be a boolean variable, then I can simply use action equals store true, default equals false, for example, and I also have a help. So now I have three arguments, one of which is mandatory, and this is the file name. And these two take strings or whatever, and these two doesn't take anything, and it's simply if it's there, then a boolean is true, and if it's not, a boolean is going to be false. Okay, so now if I run Python argparse example, I'm going to see, well, I had one mandatory file argument, and that's this file name. So I have to run Python argparse example my file. Now I'm printing these here, so args.filename here is my file, and second arg is empty because I didn't provide it. And as I'm not verbose, because standardly verbose is false here, I don't have anything here. So I could, for example, minus s second arc. Now I have the second arc here. So I could just as well have a long and a short version, so I could minus minus second minus argument and second arc. Okay, and if I additionally have the minus v for verbose, it's printing I am so verbose because now this is true. Nice quick way of making arguments. And I already hinted at that when talking about the... and if you use the minus h or minus minus help, it's going to tell you how to use it. So you have one position argument here, and that's the help I just provided. And you have these option arguments, and this is how you can run it, for example. Okay, so this here means it's optional if it's in these brackets. And I already explained you can use argparse for logging, and this is done like this. So this is how basically every file looks for me, at least every executable file. So always the main function, here. And then I always have this pass command line args, and then I also have a setup logging. And this command line argument, I have the minus and minus log. And then I can set the log level. And now this code, which is taken from the tutorial for logging, will simply make the string here. It's going to use the constant, which is defined in the logging module. And it's going to set the logging level to that very constant. Okay, so now if I run Python, so now we see if I have a warning here inside, so I have a warning here out in my main, and I have an info here, and basically I also have another warning. Okay, so if I run it standardly, it's going to use the warning, so I won't see the info here. So now if I simply run it, I don't see the info. If I run logging file minus minus log equals debug, for example, I would also see the info. So this is how it's really nice, and this is how you get rid of your prints. Instead of having, so if you have debug prints, this is how you do it, debug logs instead. If you run it inside Jupyter, you have to make sure to restart the kernel in between. All right, as much for multiple files and imports.